Well, welcome to all of you here today in attendance, and glad that you've come for this special service of testimony. In just a few moments, we're going to be having the first candidate enter the water, and Carrie on the piano is going to lead us in a song, just the first couple of verses of "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus," and so you can just follow the words up on the screen and sing as you're seated. And we appreciate the Murrays helping us with musical ministry today. It's always important, it's always necessary, I believe, as well, when we come to a baptismal service to lay the scriptural foundation for doing that which we do. And you know, we're not talking about a tradition as much as we are a presence of the Spirit of God in directing New Testament believers to follow Christ in baptism after their conversion. And then we had the presence of the Spirit of God empowering individuals to write the New Testament scriptures and give to us the foundation for this ordinance of baptism. And so I'd like to read for you some verses of scripture as we lay this foundation this morning from Acts chapter 2, beginning at verse number 1, where it says this: "When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place." This is all of the apostles were gathered together. They had just appointed Matthias, as the one who would replace Judas Iscariot, the betrayer of the Lord Jesus Christ. Judas Iscariot had already committed suicide. He went out into eternity, we believe, without Christ. But they appoint this Matthias. And what happens is, as they're meeting together in one place, suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared unto them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And notice, all those present were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. We know that these were known languages, because we're told a little later on in chapter 2 that every person heard an individual speak in their own language. A little later on, Peter begins to preach, and part of his message was this. Verse 21, "And it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Then he would say this: "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested or authenticated by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know." He's speaking of this Jesus Christ, Son of God, Son of Man. "Him being delivered," notice, "by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God," Calvary did not take the Father at all by surprise. He knew from eternity past that he would provide his Son to die on the old rugged cross to pay the penalty for mankind's sin. And notice, "You have taken by lawless hands, you've crucified and you've put him to death, whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be held by it." Everyone loves the end of a message, right? And it was in Peter's day when he preached this message on the day of Pentecost. These were his final words. Verse 36, "Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord," or master, "and Christ." Now when they heard this, notice, the audience were cut to the heart. They were convicted of their sin. And they said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, "Men and brothers, what shall we do?" Then Peter answered them and said, "Repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And notice, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Then it says, "Those who gladly received the message that Peter preached were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added unto them." This is the passage of Scripture that we will share a little later on by way of message time. But this is a foundation for us from the New Testament Scriptures regarding this important ordinance of believers' baptism. I'm going to ask you to follow Carrie as she leads us in the singing of I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. Great. Thank you so very much. Well, this is Emileigh. Okay, Emileigh Whittaker. And we have Emileigh and her mom with us in the baptismal waters today. Emily's mom is a faithful servant here at Bethel Baptist. She's our church secretary and is involved in many areas of ministry. So, Emileigh, I have a question for you today. How old are you?
9.
She's 9 years of age, going on 10. And what's your school that you attend?
J.D. Hogarth.
J.D. Hogarth. Okay. Now, I understand today that you have a number of family members present. And we're going to ask them just to wave their hands where they are, okay? If you're part of the Whittaker family and you're related to Emileigh, or you're a friend of Emily's who's come for her baptism, just wave your hand like that, okay? Okay, that's great. You see them all? We won't make them stand this morning, will we? No, we're not going to do that. But we're delighted to have you here in the baptismal waters. We had a wonderful interview, you and your mom and I, back. I'll tell you, it was in the month of November, and she's been waiting quite a while for this baptismal day, and I applaud you for that. And so we asked Emileigh, are you willing to read your testimony? She had it all printed out and so on. And she said she'd rather have her mom do that this morning, okay? So we're going to have Kristen just take Emily's testimony. We're going to put it up on the screen here. But you listen to this testimony as Kristen reads it.
Hi, my name is Emileigh Whittaker, and I want to tell you about why I'm getting baptized. I'm getting baptized because I love God, and I know He loves me too, and I really want to follow Him for the rest of my life and please Him. Every day, I want Him to be with me. I became a Christian 2 years ago when I asked Jesus into my heart by myself in my room, and later I prayed with my dad to fully accept Jesus and give my life to Him.
Well, that's fantastic. That sounds good to me. To you as well, right? Well, Emileigh, I have one question for you today, and it's simply this. Are you a true believer in Jesus Christ?
Yes.
You are. Well, upon your own profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, in obedience to our Lord's command, and this has been at your own request, your mom and I are delighted to baptize you today in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay. Praise the Lord. Okay, that's just great. Okay.
Thank you.
a delight this morning to welcome our second candidate into the baptismal waters. And this is Eli Matthew Murray. And you got your dad with you today. Are you glad about that?
Yeah.
That's good. So am I. Good to have you here, Matt. I will say this, that when I went to the Murray home and had my interview with Eli, he brought home that day some Timbits. I'll tell you, I love Timbits. But seeing I was getting close to supper hour, I said I'd take them home. And I took them home. I had a couple for my wife and a couple for me. And they were good. But better than all that, our interview together was just outstanding. And you're going to see this reflected in the testimony of Eli. Now, Eli, you are how old?
12 years old.
And you're going on 13. Teenager, pretty soon, officially. And you have a couple of sisters, mm-hmm. right? They were here on the platform this morning. You got your mom over here. And you also have some family members here. Yeah, and if you're connected with the Murrays today, would you just wave your hands where you are? We'd like to locate you. That's pretty good. That's good. Thank you so very much. And we're delighted to have you here today. And you go to what school?
Allura Public
School. Allura Public, and you're in grade?
7.
Grade 7. Okay, growing up. Well, Eli, I'm wondering, would you like to share your testimony right now? That would be great.
Sure. Hi, my name is Eli Murray. I have had the privilege of growing up in a strong Christian family. I became a Christian myself on November 2nd, 2014, when I was 4 years old while doing devotions with my mom. We always went to church unless someone in our house wasn't feeling well. I haven't always been strong in my faith. I used to think of church as more of a routine. Now I enjoy the privilege of having a relationship with God. Over the past year, I felt a closer relationship with God and felt that God was pushing me to get baptized. Over the time of my life, I have learned to love and cherish my faith in Jesus Christ. I am thankful that I have such kind and patient parents that teach me about God. I enjoy spending time with God, praying and reading His Word. I am happy that I know God is leading me and that He loves me. I always have a family prayer time before bed. We sing Jesus Loves Me all the time before bed. Then my mom says the Bible verse, Numbers 6, verse 24 through 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift His countenance upon you and give you peace. I'm grateful for the opportunity to proclaim my faith in God. I'm glad I have a personal faith with Jesus Christ because that is why I'm here today, to share publicly what I have known to be true in my heart for a long time.
Amen. That's great, Eli. We thank the Lord for you. And just one question for you today. And it's simply this. Eli, are you a true believer in the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Upon your own profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because of your desire to follow Him in believer's baptism today, your dad and I are delighted to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
Would you stand with me as we pray now? We're going to pray for the candidates, and at the conclusion of our prayer time, we're going to ask the children to be dismissed for their Sunday school time. So I will pray with you children before you leave, okay? So just stay here, and then we'll dismiss you. Lord, what a wonderful privilege it has been to officiate the baptism of these two young people. Grateful for Emily. Thankful for the day 2 years ago when she gave her heart to Jesus Christ. Also, thank you for Eli today, the clarity of his testimony as well. We're thankful, Lord, that you saved him by your grace. And both of these young people have had the privilege of growing up in a Christian home where they have a mom and dad who know the Savior and are seeking to raise them in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. And I pray that these parents would be strong in you and in the power of your might in these days as they seek to raise their families to trust you and to follow you. And Lord, we thank you for the children's ministry here at Bethel Baptist, and we're praying as our children go to their Sunday school time, the younger ones as well as the older ones, I pray that you would really bless the teachers, use their ministry mightily in the lives of these young ones. And Lord, I pray that we would hear of children as well as adults in the days to come who want to follow you in baptism if they've not done so already. And so we commit this time to you and thank you for it. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. And children, you can move quietly to the foyer, and then some of you downstairs, and then others of you to this main level for your Sunday school time. How we bless the Lord for faithful teachers here at Bethel Baptist. They prepare each and every week for ministry to young ones. And I would like you this morning, if you have your Bibles with you or if you have your Bible on a device, to take your Bible and turn to the passage of Scripture that we read just a few moments ago, Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. I'd like to share with you a baptismal meditation today, simply entitled, The Church's First Baptism. The Church's First Baptism from Acts chapter 2. Now, perhaps you're thinking that I'm going to address the first baptismal service that was ever held in Bethel Baptist Church decades ago. Well, I'm not going to do that. There was a first baptism, a New Testament baptism, connected with this group of believers that met. Some of them that are here this morning remember those early days of Bethel Baptist and the way in which God moved mightily in this congregation, bringing people to a saving knowledge of Christ and then seeing these new converts follow the Lord in immersion in water. But most of those who were part of that early time are gone home to be with the Lord. They knew the Savior, and when Christ came to get them in death, he took them immediately to be with himself. But we're not here to talk about that first baptism held at Bethel Baptist. What we're here to do today is to address the first water baptism that was ever held for what's called the universal church, the church which is Christ's body, made up of believers all the way from the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2 right up to the present. And the baptism that is commanded by the Lord Jesus Christ for all who will follow him in this way, up to the time period when Jesus Christ comes back to catch up his church to meet the Lord in the air. And so we have the church of Jesus Christ. It's worldwide in nature. It's made up of some who have already gone on to be with the Lord, but it's made up of many believers here today, as well as in other local churches throughout our world. Some have already met today. There have been other baptisms in local churches that have taken place on this that's called the Lord's Day. But here we are today to remember and to celebrate with two who have followed the Lord in this way in what is called the local church. Now, the first local church was inaugurated on the day of Pentecost in a place called the City of Jerusalem. At that time period, it was made up only of Jewish believers. Eventually, Gentiles would come to Christ and would worship with Jewish believers in many different parts of the world as the apostles went out and they preached the gospel to every part of the world, the then known world. I think some of you remember first things that have been important in your life and significant to you in days gone by. Some of you remember your first child that was born. And even some of you as men cried as that little one came into the world. And I did when our first child came. Some of you remember the first car that you ever drove. And you drove it ever so carefully. And then there was that first accident. And we don't like to remember that. And then some of you remember the first place that you lived in outside of where your mom and dad lived, and you lived with them for many years. So it was an apartment or perhaps a single family dwelling or a duplex or your first place, and that was an exciting time in your life. Some of you remember your first job. Oh, you loved it until things started to unravel a bit. And then you thought about your second job and what have you. You know, first things are important to us or should be important to us in our lives. And such was the case in the early church, the first church established in the city of Jerusalem. For Jewish believers, the apostles were present. And then on this day of Pentecost, there were the first converts to Christianity. In fact, on that day, the day of Pentecost, there were 3,000 who were saved, and shortly thereafter on that day, there were that many who followed the Lord in believers' baptism, a massive baptism, the first baptism for not just the church of Jesus Christ, but the first local church that was established. And so this morning we come to a number of features surrounding this baptismal service that took place for so many. And I'd like to share these particular features with you today. We'll abbreviate our study together, but I believe it's important for all of us to understand what characterized that day of Pentecost and this first baptism in Jerusalem. First of all, I want you to notice in verse number 37, there was a proclamation. There was a proclamation. And here's what we read, notice in verse number 37. Now, when they heard this, the question is simply this: heard what? What was the first proclamation about? Well, it had to do with the gospel message. The word gospel simply means good news. If you were to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the Apostle Paul would say, you know, I deliver to you that which I also received, that the Lord Jesus died according to the scriptures, he was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. That good news message that was preached by the Apostle Peter on this day of Pentecost in verse number 14 down to the end of verse number 36 was good news to these Jewish listeners. Listen, it's the same good news today. In a bad news world, there is the great news of how you, how I can be ready for eternity. There's a lot of people that drift through their life in these days thinking that they're right with God. And they argue that I'm a good person, I'm moral, I'm upright. Well, the bad news today is simply this. That's a lie. That is a lie. You might think you're good enough to get to heaven, but the scriptures tell us this, that all have sinned. All of us have broken God's law And all of us need to be delivered from our sin. And so, Peter, in this message, I want you to notice what he says in verse number 21. It shall come to pass that whoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Then he says something to his listeners that really gripped their heart because they knew it was true. He says, you men of Israel, you Jews, Peter was a Jew as well. He says, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth was approved, authenticated by Almighty God because of the signs and the wonders and the miracles that he performed. Did Jesus Christ raise people from the dead? He certainly did. Did he heal the deaf as well as the dumb, those who couldn't speak? Absolutely. He healed the sick, and he proved that he was the sent one of God by the things that he did, but also by the things that he said. And it says this in verse 22, that God did those things by him in the midst of you. You yourselves know this. They had heard of Jesus Christ. But notice he says, Peter says, him he was delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, but you have taken him, you've crucified him, you have killed him. And so his message to these listeners was simply this: listen, you're responsible in part for Christ dying on Calvary. But my dear friends, I'm here today as a preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ to tell each one of you, as my own heart is told, that my sins and your sins were paid on the cross of Calvary. But it demands a willingness by you and by me to acknowledge our sinfulness and then turn to Jesus Christ to be our Savior, to be our Lord, and to cleanse our sins away. The good news proclaimed to sinful people who'd committed a horrendous, murderous act, crucifixion, was about the one who Pilate said three times over concerning, I find no fault in him. Listen, you'll find lots of fault in me. If I live with you long enough or know you long enough, I'll find enough faults in you. But I present to you today Jesus Christ, who did no sin. Neither was any guile found in his mouth. The perfect, sinless, spotless Lamb of God. Now listen, there's bad news, and the bad news is this. You're a sinner, I'm a sinner. There's bad news as well. If you die in your sin, outside of Jesus Christ, you'll go out into a Christless eternity without him. But here's the good news. Jesus Christ came for you personally. He came and he died on Calvary's cross for your sin and for mine. And listen, he wants you to be reconciled with him. But you must admit you're a sinner, and you must admit that he is the sinless one. And you must call upon the name of the Lord to be saved. A lady by the name of Rosalind Goforth, writing about her husband Jonathan's missionary work in China, recounts this. Some months after our arrival in China, an old experienced missionary came to my husband with the following advice. Do not attempt to speak of Jesus the first time on preaching to a pagan audience. The Chinese have a prejudice against the name of Jesus. By the way, they're not alone. Confine your efforts to demolishing the false gods. And if you have a second opportunity, you may bring in Jesus. That was not good advice. Later, when telling me of the advice that he had been given, my husband exclaimed with hot emphasis, never, never, never. The gospel which saved the down and outers in the slums of Toronto is the same gospel that must save Asian sinners. Years later, more than one missionary came to my husband asking, what is the secret of your power to get men out of such depths of sin? The reply was simply this: I simply believe and teach what God's word proclaims. Some have replied, but you cannot preach to a proud Confucian scholar the same as to the common crowd. Then Dr. Goforth would answer, there is no royal road to God. Rich or poor, Chinese or Canadian, educated or non-educated, all are sinners and must need come to the same Savior by the same road. There was a proclamation. But notice, secondly, there was conviction. For we read, notice this in verse number 37. Now when they heard this message of Peter's, they were pricked in their heart. They were pricked in their heart. They were pricked of what? They were convicted of, notice, their sin. Peter had said, you're in part responsible for this Jesus being crucified and being killed. And that bothered them. And it should bother you as it bothered me many years ago when I heard this message, that it was my sin that he died for on Calvary. And my heart was convicted by the Holy Spirit of my need to trust Christ as Lord and Savior. The word here, pricked, means pierced or stabbed. I have a dear friend. He's now recently moved to New Brunswick. But he was a tremendous youth director for years here in Ontario. A number of years ago, when I was living in the vicinity close to him, he and his wife rented out some community gardens. And one day, he came to me and his thumb was swollen up, incredibly. And I said, Gary, what happened? He said, you would not believe. I went to the community garden today and I tried to pull up a carrot from the ground and a sliver of the carrot went under my thumb. He says, the pain is still excruciating. And that pain went on for a period of time until he got that sliver out and was able to see the healing process take place. That's the same kind of stabbing or pain that was thrust into the heart of these Jewish listeners as they listened to Peter's message. They knew they were guilty. And it was the Holy Spirit of John 16, verse 7, who reproves of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment to come. What pierced them? It was the truth that they were sinners in need of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. So there was a proclamation, Peter's message. There was conviction, the conviction of the Holy Spirit. But notice this third feature. There was a question. And the question in verse 37 was simply this. They said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? What shall we do? This question was one that they asked, and it was a good question to ask. It's always a good question to ask. Whenever you hear the scriptures proclaimed, the way we seek to do it here at Bethel, there needs to be a personal application to a heart. It's not enough to listen with the ear, but it's important to ask the question in your heart, now that I've heard this, what do I do with it? And so the right question was asked. And today, as this question perhaps is asked in your heart, you've asked the right question, but you'll do one of two things with that question. You'll either accept the answer or you'll reject the answer. And sometimes in accepting the answer that is given, Satan will come and say, just wait. Another day you can respond to that question. Just procrastinate. You don't need to do so. Sadly enough, some procrastinate to the point of death and never ever get that question properly resolved in their heart. So there was a question. Fourthly, this feature, there was a call to salvation. For notice, when they said, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Peter, the one who preached the message, said this, "Repent, repent." You know, I preach at a lot of funeral services. And oftentimes I'll preach and share a funeral meditation to people who, by and large, have never heard too much this term, repent. This word repent is a Bible term. It was used by Jesus Christ. It was also used here by Peter. It was used by the Apostle Paul and so on. And this is a term, a word that means a change of mind that leads to a change of direction. Perhaps some of you received a personal invitation to come today to this service for whatever reason. You had a choice. The choice you made was to accept that invitation to come. But you could have rejected that invitation. You could have changed your mind, which would have resulted in a change of direction. Rather than coming here, you would have stayed where you were or go somewhere else. In the spiritual realm, when Peter says repent, he says this: change your mind about yourself. You're saying, really, I'm not that bad a sinner, when the Lord says, you are a sinner, regardless of how great or how small. Your sin has separated you from me. And then you had to change your mind, or you need to change your mind perhaps this morning about Jesus Christ. Perhaps he's only a swear word in your vocabulary. Perhaps you're one who maybe doesn't blaspheme the Lord Jesus, but you disregard him. Or you say, well, he was just simply a good teacher, and that's for the people who want to be religious in life. No, he's God in flesh. He's perfect God, perfect man. He loves you with an everlasting love. That's why he came to this old sin-cursed earth. He came to die for you and for me and for the entire world. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Peter appeals to them to repent, to come to this wonderful salvation, which is provided by Christ and Christ alone. In Acts 3:19, Peter and John would preach this message: repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins might be blotted out, washed away. A number of years ago in the city of Guelph, we had a wonderful youth program in a church, and I had the privilege of being part of that youth group. We had a number of teenagers that came to that group who came from either mainline churches where they had never heard this truth of repentance and salvation. One of those girls who came was a young lady by the name of Marilyn. A lovely girl. In fact, she came regularly. She'd go to her church in the morning and never hear the gospel, but she would come to youth group on Sunday night and hear about this person called Jesus Christ and how much he loved her and wanted her to be saved from her sin. I remember as a youth leader going to her on one occasion, we sat down in the youth room, and I said, "Marilyn, have you ever put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ for eternal life?" She says, "Yes." She says, "I've been a very good person." She says, "I love going to church, and I love this youth group." I said, "That's not the question. Have you ever repented of your sin and believed in Christ for eternal life?" She says, "Repent?" I said, "Yes." And I took her to Luke 13:3, where it says this: "I tell you, no, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish." She says, "I don't like that word. That means I'm going to have to change." I says, "Yes, Marilyn, Even as good a person as you appear to be, you need to change your mind about yourself and Jesus Christ, and you need to come to him for salvation. It wasn't any more than 3 weeks later. On a Sunday night, she came and she said, Bob, she says, I repented of my sin last night. I gave my heart to Jesus Christ. I said, Marilyn, you're one of the saved ones. You're now a child of God based upon the authority of God's word. I appeal to you today, if you're here without Jesus Christ, be reconciled to God through Christ. Finally, I want you to notice this. There was this feature, and it was simply, there was a command to identify with Jesus Christ. To identify. Identification. Some of you are not aware, but we had a gentleman, married man, a father, in the baptismal waters with us today. His name is Matt. He's the father of Eli. Some of you don't realize, but he's in law enforcement. Okay? I'm always careful what I do when I'm in his presence. You chuckle. But there was a number of years ago that Matt did his training for law enforcement. And he was eventually designated as a law enforcement personnel. Police officer. Now listen. When he wore his uniform, people would say, oh, this man's a police officer. The reality was simply this. He had already identified with law enforcement. He'd already been accepted. And whether or not he had the uniform on or not, including today, he's still a police officer. He does what needs to be done, what he was called to do. Baptism is like that. Baptism is putting on the uniform, identifying with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection in immersion in water. And so perhaps for some of you today, you've been saved. There's no question. You would say, I'm a child of God by faith in Christ and Christ alone, but I've never identified with Christ in baptism. Baptism does not save. Baptism does not wash away sin, but baptism is the answer of a good conscience toward God. How do we identify? We identify by being baptized. You'll notice in verse number 38, we need to ask the question, is verse 38 teaching that water baptism removes and washes away sin? Listen, some churches believe and proclaim that it does. But in verse number 38, you'll notice this. It says, and I read, repent and then be baptized, salvation and then baptism, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Some use this verse of scripture to teach baptismal regeneration. That you get this new life in Christ by trusting Christ, but you must be baptized in order to have one's sins washed away. What's interesting is simply this. When you read verse number 38, and then you read concerning what Peter did, the other apostles did in preaching the gospel, what Jesus even said, none of Peter's, none of Christ's, or the other apostles' messages ever teach that water baptism is antecedent, or it precedes, or it comes before salvation. You'll never find it anywhere mentioned that baptism comes before salvation. Never. Then secondly, notice this. The preposition for, okay, so it says for the remission of sins in verse 38 can mean for the purpose of. But it's best understood in this verse of scripture, meaning because of, which means simply what? Because of one's repentance. because of that, then baptism needs to take place in the life of the new believer or the older believer in Jesus Christ. It's because of our remission of sins. It's because of the gift of the Holy Spirit received at the moment of conversion. It's because of this that one follows the Lord in the waters of baptism. I would love to ask for a show of hands this morning of those of you who are saved. You've been converted. You've invited Christ into your heart to take away your sin. But I won't ask you to do that this morning. I'd also like to ask for those of you who would raise your hand that you're a believer in Christ, have you followed Christ in the waters of baptism? But I wouldn't do that either this morning. However, I appeal to your heart today. If you're not saved, get saved today. Now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. And if you have been saved, if you never follow Christ in baptism, I would encourage you to be part of the next baptismal service that we will hold. Listen, if these children can obey the Lord, then you as adults or even teenagers can follow the Lord. I will say this, if you've been saved and you've never been baptized, then you're being disobedient. And I would encourage you to be obedient to the Lord in regard to this important ordinance of baptism. Amen. Amen.